worship you together. You are here when we gather. In your presence there is power. When we worship you together, you are here. When we worship you together, you are here. When we worship you together, you are here. When we gather. When we gather,
well, good morning, everyone. Can you hear me? Hear me? Yeah. Today I'm doing announcements. As you notice, I'm not Sarah. My name is Joey. I'm the pastor of this church. Welcome to Calvary Community Church, a fellowship of deaf and hearing believers. Welcome all of you here together. Some announcements. You don't hear it? Testing one. I thought you said you could hear me. I guess I'm loud enough. Testing one. Testing two. I coolly count to 10. Please fix it. 3, 4. Testing 5. Testing 6. Testing 7. Testing. Oh, yeah, 8, testing 9, testing 10. No? Not working? Your brain, number 1. This is number 2, so it's crap, probably. Testing 2, testing 3, testing 4. You can hear me on this? Testing 1, testing 2, testing 3, testing 4. You hear me now?
Yes.
Yay, hallelujah. Now you can hear my wonderful voice. All right. As I said, do I have to go all the way back again? Today is an announcement. Tuesday night Bible study, 7 p.m., same as usual. There's a women's retreat on March 31st. There's a deadline to sign up, April 7th through 9th. There's flyers back there. If you need information, talk with Sherry, the lady that's raising her hands right there. There's a state rally, a deaf state rally going on in the Riverside on May 26th to 28th at Calvary Deaf Church. If you need information, I believe we have flyers back there, right? Yes, flyers back there. Let's see, next week we have church fellowship together at the church. We're going to go to a place called LA Brisket. It's a barbecue place where they have delicious food. They make sandwiches, brisket sandwiches. It's barbecue. If you like that stuff, join us at the church. We'll go over there and fellowship. It's right down Pioneer, not too far from here. April 16th, church service will be at 11 a.m. for Easter service, 11 a.m. And you see on the flyer, it asks to please to donate some eggs. I'm not talking about real eggs, please. Plastic eggs. And some candy. So we have an Easter egg hunt here. Are you kids excited? And you adults, if you want. But we'll limit you to 5 eggs. We need to leave the rest to the kids. That's all for announcements. Now it's time for Run for Funds. For those of you who don't know what Run for Funds is, we give out $1 bills for the kids to run and gather for kids camp. It's expensive, so we as a church support each other as a body of Christ, and we give $1 so they could go, and it's all paid for. There's no burden on the parent. Are you ready? Get ready. Get set. Get set number two. Go. Awesome running, girls and boys. Thank you for your help in supporting this. Really appreciate it. Now it's time for tithe and offering. Oh, you guys volunteer? All right. Come on up. You get a run again? Well, we're going a little bit slower when we go by. Good idea to tie your shoe. Chloe, this one. Time for your tithe and offering. If it's your first time here, please fill out the welcome cards. Get ready. Get set. Get set number two. Ah, you didn't fall for it this time. Go. Chloe, this way. And you go through the road. We also have an iPad back there, which we left in the office. We're going to go get in a minute where you can pay through the iPad. Oh yeah, I forgot. Over here, we have BID, Bible Institute for the Deaf, we support in the Philippines. We have coins, you can put it in here. Scott, can you turn off the heater, please? All right. Thank you. I'm going to pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for everything you've done for us. you provided for us as we turned back in faith. We paid our tithes and offerings to you, Lord. This money supports your kingdom to advance it. We thank you, Lord. And I ask you to continue blessing everyone here. If they have any financial needs, Lord, I ask you to touch them and provide for them. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, girls. Time for the worship team to come up.
God, you are amazing. You created a people to sing of your love and endless mercy. We will sing to exalted above the praise of your people. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Holy, holy, holy is your name, exalted above praise of your stronger than you, powerful God, your hand is mighty, and all creation will hear of your name, and every knee will bow before you. We will sing to are filled with your glory. Holy, holy, holy is your name, exalted above the praise of your people. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Holy, holy, holy is your name, exalted above the praise of your people. There is none above you, none beside you. There is none like you. There is none above you, none beside you. There is none like you. There is none above you. beside you. There is none like you. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Holy, holy, holy is your name, exalted above the praise of your people. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Holy, holy, holy is your name, exalted above the praise of your people. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Holy, holy, holy is your name, exalted above the praise of your people. There is none above you, none beside you. There is none like you. There is none above you, none beside you. There is none like you. There is none above you, none beside you. There is none like you. There is none above you, none beside you. There is none like you. You're high and lifted up. You're high and lifted up. You're high and lifted up. High and lifted as we lift our hands in worship and glorify your name. You deserve the glory and the honor. As we lift our hands in worship and glorify your name, you are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You deserve the glory and the honor as we lift our hands in worship and glorify your name. You deserve the glory and the honor as we lift our hands in worship and glorify your name. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You deserve the glory and the honor as we lift our hands in worship and glorify your name. You deserve the glory and the honor as we lift our hands in worship and glorify your name. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. You are great. You do miracles so great. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you. There is no one else like you.
There's no one like him. That's for sure. Esther, I'm going to pray. Father, Heaven, Lord, we here invite you. Holy Spirit, we invite you to come and flow among us all. Lord, I'm here to preach your words. Fill me with your Spirit. Overflow. Help us understand your words clearly. This is precious. I thank you, Lord, for being with us, for giving us your gift, even though we don't deserve it, Lord. You're an awesome God. I thank you for that. Thank you, Jesus' name, for it. Amen. We'll start off with the comics. If King Solomon was in charge of the U.S. presidential election, if you know the story, there was two moms, one child, and they both were saying, that was my child. So King Solomon was full of wisdom. So, okay, we'll just slice it in half and give it to both of you. True mother, no. You give it to her because she loved the child so much, she's willing to give it up. King Solomon knew that was the mother. So we don't want to divide the United States. I get best as many as 15 two-edged swords with this unit. I usually say not to believe everything you read, but this is the exception. Believe everything it says. Last week, I talked about WOW. I'm not talking about the game, WOW game. Weapons of war. So I talked about the armor of God. And I focused on the one weapon of war, the sword. How many of you have a sword at home? Raise your hand. Well, you have a knife. Have a little thing. This is what I have. I use it for many different things. When my kids get toys, you know, those strappy things, they're so hard to get off. That helps me a lot. Or when the spider comes, you know, I better use my shotgun than this knife if I see a spider. But as we see the knife, it's dull right now because I've been using it a lot. And I need to sharpen it so it becomes sharpened again to use it. I'm going to close it, put it away if I poke myself on accident. But as I continue with the weapon of war, the sword, today is part two from last week. Today, how to become a pro, an expert at using the sword. I'm not talking about the real sword, because when we fight against the enemy of darkness, that sword is worthless. My knife I have here is worthless. Not going to work. We fight with his words. This is the sword that he has given us. If you use it effectively, you can fight Satan like Jesus did in the wilderness. For 40 days, 40 nights, he fasted. Then Satan came up. He defeated him through the word of God. But that is the sword that defeats him. Nothing else. Any of you like pro sports? Baseball? Okay, I'm glad I'm not the only one that likes baseball. Football, basketball, tennis. We got a tennis fan over there. Golf. Anyone like golf? Yeah, I'm sure some of you like golf. That's okay. Now, baseball is my favorite sports, okay? I like football too. In baseball, to be a pro, you have the skills, but you have to practice to become better. You have to watch the ball coming. Nowadays, we have iPads. We have all these video technology. We go watch the pitcher, see how he throws. Okay, I'm playing against him today. I'm going to study how to defeat him. He throws a lot of fastballs. I can hit that. But occasionally, he throws the curveball, which is hard. But if you know how to hit a curveball, you're good. Now, the pitchers, they will watch you. You're batting too. They'll see how you bat, where your hot zone is. So the pitcher will know where to throw it, up here, down here, or in the middle. Or if he's always hitting home, just throw it at the guy. That's what we do. I recently went to the World Baseball Classic. You know what that is? Every 4 years, we have teams from all over the world play against each other. And I get to see United States win. Yeah. Are you proud of the United States winning? Do you know why they won? Because they were motivated and they had the best players on the team. Because they practiced, you're right. 4 years ago, 8 years ago, the pros we have right now were not interested in joining that team. So we had all these minor league players playing. So they didn't win well. But this year they decided to send the pros, the good players. And these players knew how to play well. They know defense, offense. They play well. Same with God. What do you know? Defense and offense. You have the sword, the whole armor of God. You can play well. You can hit Satan with the sword if you know how to use it. Last week, I wish I brought my Jedi sword. I had brought it last week. So if I didn't know how to use it, I'd be doomed. If the three musketeers came up to me right now, I'm tapping out, I'm walking away, because I wouldn't know how to fight them. But to become an expert in using God's words, I listed 7 things we must do to become an expert. Number 1 is easy. Read and study the Word of God. Do you all have Bibles at home or here with you? I hope you brought your Bibles too. If you didn't, you have your iPhone, you have your iPads, or you have Bibles in front of you, we need to read it. Not just Sunday church, that's all you read it. Or if you come to church, say, oh, I'll see some verses up there soon. That's the word all I need. Not good enough. No. Need to read the Word of God every day. But you need to pick a time that suits you. If you're a morning person, you get up early, get up 30 minutes earlier and read the Word of God. If you like to read when your kids are in bed, when you have kids, you know, when they're in bed, it's peace and quiet. I can watch my TV shows. Or maybe you just cut off one TV show and read the Word of God. You have to make time for Him to study. Like when you're taking the test, you need to study for a test, right? When you're a student in school, some of you are students right now, you have to study to get a good grade. If you don't study, you're going to fail. Same with Satan, he's going to come. So how are you going to defeat him? By the Word of God. If you don't know the Word of God, he's going to devour you. Easy prey. As I said before, a lion, when they hunt for food, who are they going to look for? The tiniest, weakest animal. They're not going to go after the mama and the father. The deer, the big antlers. Big. I'm not messing with that deer. I'm going to mess with that little tiny cute Bambi thing right there. And that's dinner. The same with us. If we don't know the word of God, we're Bambi. Those cute little eyes, all innocent and delicious. I don't want to be like that. I want those huge antlers. Come on, you're going to mess with me. The word of God, if you know how to use it, you're going to go boom on Satan. Because I know it's not by my power, but his power. And that's how I will defeat Satan. So you have to read the word of God. Sometimes we listen to sermons on TV, on the radio, or we read devotional. On my iPhone, I have an app called iDisciple. I love it. I read different disciples. Different devotionals, right? Devotionals. I enjoy it. It's good. But when you read the Word of God directly, it's better. The devotional is beneficial, yes. Reading the Word of God is good as well. I encourage you. Then our knowledge grows. And we have more weapons against Satan. Have you know John 3:16? It's a famous verse, John 3:16. Almost every Christian knows that. It's one of the most famous verses. You see that wrestling all the time, right? John 3:16. I don't know if it's a reference for the Bible verse or for To the Rock. I don't know. Well, if you know that verse, that's good. But if that's the only thing you know, Satan, you might just shoot it one time, boom. He's still going to come. You need ammo. This is your ammo. Defeating Satan. In our life, we have many, many different struggles. But we need to know the Word of God for each of the struggles. The Word encourages all. If I'm struggling in this part of life, I want to know what verse will help me in that life, part of my life. I was seeking. Thank God nowadays we have our iPhones. We can just type in and Google. I'm depressed. Boom, pop up all the verses. And I can read it. Boom, 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 against Satan. Because I have hope in God. When I'm depressed, when I'm hurting, I need to look to God's words. When I try to depend on myself, I will fail. Let's go to our first verse in the day. Colossians chapter 3, verse 16. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly and teach you, admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. How do you sing? Good. If you're deaf, you can sign a sing too. Boom, boom, boom. Sing in your head. Sing in the shower. Sing wherever you are. When you sing with the Lord, you connect. It's lifting. Because Satan will try to put a message in your head. Have you heard that when you hear a song, it stays stuck in your head? So when you have Satan trying to put something in your head, sing a song and continue, and it goes in your head. And you endure Satan's message. Second Timothy chapter 3, 16 to 17. So we have 3:16 again. All scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. So that the servant of God may be truly equipped for every good work. This will equip us. Different parts of life we're struggling with, there's something there for us. God has a word for each one of us in every area of our lives. It rebukes me sometimes. I'm making a mistake and I read it like, oh, I need to correct that. When I was a baby Christian, it trained me that I learned that grow with him. I was not left alone. Okay, Lord, I'm a new believer. What do I do now? It trains me. It's my dummy's guide how to be with the Lord. You know, this book, Dummies, How to Plant a Garden. There's so many different books. It helps me grow. I need training. When I became a youth pastor a long time ago, I was a rookie and I made lots of rookie mistakes. One person invited me to their home. He just bought a brand new home. And he just unexpectedly tapped me. Hey, do you mind blessing my house? Okay, it's the first time I ever gone in the house to pray. So I went in the house. Lord, I ask you to bless this food for our body. Oops. Because I'm so used to blessing my food, and I blessed the food in this house instead of his house. Trainee. Well, sorry. That person must have food in this room or something. So it's experience. I get trained. I improve, become better. I learn how to pray. And because I had that opportunity, I got to learn how to pray. God gives us opportunities to train us. Sure, we make mistakes once in a while. As we grow, we become better. He gives us opportunities all the time. When we get hit by life, we know who to turn to him. He makes us stronger if you turn to him. But if you don't turn to him, we become weaker. And we let Satan step on us more. And Satan's not going to stop stepping on you. He's going to continue stepping on you. He's going to jump on you until you blast him away with God's words. Jesus didn't allow Satan to step on him. Number two, pray for understanding the word. There's a lot in here. Sometimes it's hard to understand. Sometimes we struggle. So we ask him, Lord, help me understand. He sent the Holy Spirit when Jesus went to heaven. We have the Holy Spirit, but we have to use him. We have to fight him. Come, help me understand. If you don't understand, read it again until you understand. I don't get it. Nah, I'm done. No. You need to read it. Again, until you understand it. My girls sometimes struggle with a math question. Sometimes I struggle with the two. Now, the 2 + 2 is pretty hard, right? But when you practice, you finally understand. 2, 2. Ah, I get it. 8 = 5. 4. Will you read it again to understand it? But you want to ask who to understand the word of God. Who? The author, right? So you ask him. Before you read it, pray, Lord, I'm going to read your words. Help me understand it. So I want to know you more. I want to understand you. Ask him before you read. For Psalms 119, verse 12 and verse 27. Praise to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. Verse 27. Cause me to understand the ways of your precepts. that I may meditate on your wonderful deeds. So we have King David asking him to understand his words. King David was wise. Yes, he made mistakes in his life, but he still depended on God. God could have just thrown him out, finished with it, gave him mercy and love, and he knew he needed him to go through the rest of his life. Depended on him. For Psalms again, 119, verse 18. Open my eyes that I can see the wonderful things in your law. It's a wonderful thing. Before we were Christians, or those unbelievers, they said, I don't want to follow. I'm going to miss out the good things in life. Have you heard that before? I want to enjoy life first. They think the Word of God is no good for them. But it's really wonderful for you because it directs your life. It gives you joy. It gives you life. It teaches you that life here on earth is short. And we have eternity in heaven with God. And it tells us all the hope we have in Him. One thing I hate on earth is what? Pain. Because it hurts. Who likes getting hurt? I don't. I don't like crying. I don't like my heart broken. I don't like stubbing my toe on something. It hurts. But in heaven, we have the promise that there'll be no pain, no tears. I'm looking forward to that. James chapter 1, verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault. It will be given to you. If you're lacking wisdom, or you know the answer to something, it says, ask Him. Ask Him. And He will give it. It's promised to us to hold on to the words that He's given us. And Satan comes and says, you're dumb. Well, I'm just going to ask God for more wisdom. I'm not dumb. Go away. But you have to get up and ask Him. Take action. Faith without works is dead. It says that in the Bible. You have to take action. Do it. Ask Him. Read the Word of God. You have to take action. And the third step becoming a pro is memorizing the Scriptures. Do you memorize all the Scriptures? I have a bad time memorizing names. But I'm good at memorizing faces. It comes, oh, I've seen you before. But names, it's bad. I forget my mom's name right now. No, I'm just kidding, I know my mom's name. But memorizing the Word of God is beneficial. I can tell you a lot of passages, but the first number sometimes I forget. I need to practice with that. Write it on the postcard. I have those little index cards at home. Write the first, the reference, John 3:16. Put the first on the back and study it. Improve. I encourage that. I encourage myself to do that as well. To improve and become better. Increase your first knowledge. Because if Satan comes with something that contradicts his words, and you read it and you show the first, no. God said this. He said this. Let me read it to you. Boom. Satan's going to run scared. It's your ammo. What good is a gun with one bullet? You want a high cap magazine, right? 10 to 30. Boom, 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 boom. That's what I want. I'll let you know it's not legal in California. You have more than 10 in your magazine. But for Satan, I'm going to have more than 30 by the 100 rounders. James chapter 1, verse 20. But whoever looks intently in the perfect law gets freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard. But in doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Don't forget the word of God. Don't forget him to continue thinking about him. Practice the word. Memorize it. Memories help. The fourth thing, meditate on the word of God. When you're meditating on him and his words, sin comes out, push it away. Satan tries to bother you. Excuse me, I'm meditating on him, my Lord and my Savior. He's going to look at you. Are you either Bambi or the father with the huge antlers? He's going to be like, oh, I'm not messing with that. Because if he knows you have plenty of ammo, he's going to be scared. It's important to meditate on him. Let's read what it says. Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. Keep this book of law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful and do everything that's written in there. Then you'll be prosperous and successful. Meditating day and night. That's important. And think about him. It helps you to be careful in everything you do. And it says you'll be successful and prosperous. When you depend on him, when you meditate on him, he helps you through life. Without him, I surely be doomed. For sure. I know that. Because of him, I try to meditate on him constantly, and he helps me through everything. But when I stop meditating on him, I get in trouble. King David again, for Psalms 119:97. How I love your law and meditate it all day long. When you meditate on his words, you ignore the sins, the temptation. Because if you're tempted, now meditate on the word of God. Because I live for it. I have a devil's line. But I have a few things that we should meditate on. One, we should meditate on God's faithfulness. That's in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. If this is so, the Lord knows how to rescue the godly from trials and to hold the unrighteousness for punishment on the day of judgment. God is faithful. And he says, those who live for him, that believe in him, have faith in him, will be saved when they arise on the day of judgment. That's the promise he has. And he also promises the unrighteous is not going to go in there. A perfect place up there. He provides them. He will take care of everything on that day. So it's such a feel on earth like it's not fair. Why is that person getting away with this? Don't worry. The Lord will take care of it. He says, vengeance is mine. He promises that. He will take care of it. He's not going to let sin go away. Not going to let it continue forever. He will take care of it one day. That's the promise he has. Meditate on love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1. If I speak in tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. We have to meditate on love. Love each other because we're the body of Christ. Because if we don't have love, everything is worthless. If a homeless person comes, God bless you, and we walk away, where's the love in that? Oh, I'll pray for you. Prayer is good, but what if he's hungry? Is he going to eat the words of prayers? No. Buy him some food. Faith without works is dead. But when you love someone, when you have love, you spend your last $10 if you have it in your wallet to feed that person. That's love. He loved us before we loved him. And he loved us while we were sinners. He gave us all the chance. All of us are here. And we will face him. And he will say, I love you. And you accepted the gift I gave it you. Welcome. That's his love. Meditate on God's mercy. Romans chapter 5, verse 8. God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we're still sinners, Christ died for us. See, there you go. There's the verse. He loved us when we were bad. He loved us when we hated him. He still loved us no matter what. And when we turn to God, Lord, I'm sorry for my sins. He gives you mercy. I don't think so. You were bad. You punched that kid yesterday. He's not like that. He gives mercy. And we should return mercy as well. Jesus on that cross, bleeding from his hand, his head, his foot. And he told the Lord to forgive them for what they didn't know what they were doing. The people that nailed him and put the crown on him, he said, forgive them. That's mercy. That's love. Meditate on God's forgiveness. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. God had made him to be no sin, to be sin for us, so we can become the righteousness of God. Jesus knew no sin, and he took our place. He suffered for us all. He forgave us for our sins. He who had no sin, he took your place, and he forgave you. Meditate on the Lord being with you. Genesis chapter 39, verse 20 to 21. Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. But while Joseph was in prison, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prisoner warden. No matter what part was happening in your life, he is with you. Joseph was thrown in prison, and God was still with him. He took care of him while he was there and promoted him. Saul, or Paul, you know, the famous apostle, he persecuted Christians. But when he repented, and he's gone through a lot, and God was with him when he was in prison, when his ship sank, when he was beaten to death, when he was stoned, close to death, God was still with him, took care of him. God is with you. You have to meditate that, remember that. When bad things happen, sometimes we think, God, where are you? That's the mistake we do sometimes. I have to realize that he is with me. It doesn't matter through the circumstances I'm going through. He is with me. That's what I have to remember. He is with me no matter what. Meditate on God's compassion. For Psalms 103, verse 13 to 14. As a father, he has compassion on his children. So the Lord has compassion on all who fear him. For he remembers how we were formed. He remembers that we're dust. God loves us like a human father, but much more. Loves us so much. We come from dust, Jira. That's what I mean. When we die, we become dust, right? But he loves us no matter what, because our souls are precious to him. His compassion. And he gives us compassion. We make mistakes. We think like, oh no, we're sinning against the Lord. We're going to hit by the head by lightning. Have you thought of that before? But no, he has compassion. He forgives you when you ask. He still loves you no matter what. You have to ask him and he gives you compassion. If he didn't give me compassion, I'd be hit by lightning thousands of times. My hair is spiky right now because of that. Meditate on the security. For Psalms 103, verse 34. I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of his hand. My Father who has given to me is greater than all. No one can snatch them out of the Father's hands. We have the security with him. No one can take us out of his hands. He protects us. And we have that promise as we go through life. And we'll meet him one day. And he will say, well done, good, faithful servant. We have that promise. As we get closer to the age, older and older and older, one day, our life will be done. But I have the security of the promise that I will see the Lord because of Jesus Christ who died on the cross that washes my sins away. So I have that security. I have that hope. So I don't have the fear of one day what's going to happen to me when I die. I have that security. I know I have insurance. Like when my car gets hit, I have insurance. They'll take care of it. So when I get hit by a car, I have insurance and I get to heaven. I'll see the Lord. Hello. So I know I have the security and I trust in him. That's the things we should meditate on. Now, number five, for becoming an expert and a pro. Remain in his words. We have to continue living in his words. Feed the hungry. Close the homeless. Take care of each other. Remain in this word. Read the word. Continue. John 15:7. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish. It will be done for you. Remain in his words. We ask him. Remain in him. John chapter 15, verse 4. Remain in me, and I remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither you can bear fruit unless you remain in me. We have the fruit of the Spirit. With love, I need him. Patience, I need him. I can't grow without him. Before I was a believer, I was not a good person. But when I remain in him, I grow. My fruit grows. The older I get, my fruit becomes better. It's stronger. But I have to remain in him. If I turn my back on him, my fruit becomes rotten. So I remain in him. I go. I make mistakes occasionally. But as I grow in him and I remain in him, those mistakes decrease. For Psalms 119, verse 114, you are my refuge and my shield. I put my hope in your words. Now, another way to become a pro, you need to use his words by sharing with others. When you share with others, you have that memory of witnessing, share with others. And you draw people to his kingdom. But you have to use them. Maybe the first time you witness, you might make a mistake. That's okay, but you have to go out and do it. Study God's words and witness and share with others. You're here because people share with you, right? You're a believer because someone shared with you. I'm here because someone shared the word of God with me. If they didn't share the word with me, I would not be here. And God commands them to go out and share the gospel with others. Wherever you are, school, work, at the park, your witnessing is by showing how you live here. Do you have compassion? Do you have kindness? Do you have love? Sometimes you don't have to speak. They watch you. You're a living witness. And it builds your faith too. For Psalms 71, verse 15, my mouth will tell of your righteous deeds, your saving acts all day long. And then I don't have to relate with them. My mouth will tell his good deeds. So I'm going to say one good thing that happened. My nephew was he went to the CHOC. You know what CHOC is? It's a children's hospital, OC. And they suspected he had an autoimmune disease. That was really scary for my sister. Scary for me because I loved my nephew so much. I was scared. But there was only one thing I could turn to was who? My God. And we prayed hard. And last week I found out they found nothing. So thank God for that. They found something, an infection. But he had to go back for a checkup again. And they did deep testing. They found nothing. So I give glory to God for his good deeds. That he doesn't have the autoimmune disease. So God is good. Good deeds there. Hallelujah. Okay. That again. Number 7. Sharpen each other's swords. When we encourage each other, we take care of each other. If one falls, we pick each other up. If we're struggling with sin, we pray for each other. Proverbs chapter 27, verse 17. As iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens one another. We encourage each other. Brothers, sisters in Christ, we need each other to pray for each other. It's hard when you fall in a hole by yourself. But when you have someone there looking down at you, hopefully they don't laugh at you at first. They could throw a rope for you and pull you up. Say, when we mess up with the Lord, we ask for forgiveness. If our brothers and sisters to come and surround us and pray and support each other, we get lifted. We have to sharpen each other, become stronger. I told you my knife is weak. Before I could cut paper, it was knife, and I'm like, I can't, so I need to sharpen again and cut the paper. My knife needs me to sharpen it. Saying we need each other to sharpen each other. James chapter 5, verse 16. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for another so you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. So we need each other. We confess our sins to each other. We pray, support each other. We need accountability partners sometimes. I'm struggling with this, brother. Can you help me? Pray for me. And check up on me. So how have you been doing? I'm doing good. Have you been reading the Word of God? Text each other. Get a Bible reading partner. Find someone. Did you read the Word of God today? I forgot. Read it now. But I'm cooking dinner. Read it now. Or could you read after dinner? This one. When your sword is spiritually sharp, you'll be able to attack the devil as effectively, I spelled it wrong, as Jesus did in the wilderness. When it's sharp, you could defeat it like Jesus did in the wilderness, the desert. It has to be sharp. And you have to do those things. This is what you want to look like. I like that picture. Going after Satan like that. I just seen Satan look like this. Running scared like that. So put on the full armor of God. Make sure your sword is sharp to defeat the enemy. And remember, to defeat the enemy, this is how you do it. Because we're not fighting against flesh and blood, but darkness. And to defeat darkness, we need him to defeat them. So we can have Satan looking like that, running scared. I want to repeat again the armor of God first. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 18. Finally, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For a struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, and against the power of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of the evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you'll be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything to stand, stand firm with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, the breastplate of righteousness in place, and your feet fitted with the readiness comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith so you extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And pray in the Spirit of all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for the Lord's people. To fight the enemy, we need his armor and his sword of the word. If you want to grow, become stronger, we need to depend on this, to live for it. And use it. Don't let dust be on it. Are you leaving it on the bookshelf full of dust? Well, now it's a good time to take it, spray some Free Breeze on it, and clean it off. And use it. If you're struggling in life, go to the Word of God. If you don't know what to do, go to the Word of God. You'll find the answers with him. God bless you all. Worship team, you have a closing song? Be calm.